The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Good morning. Welcome to worship. A special welcome to those of you who are guests with us. We're glad you've chosen to worship here at First Lutheran, and we hope you'll come back and be with us again. There is a green visitor card in the pew. If you are a guest, please fill that out and place that in the offering plate when that comes by. If it's your first time here, you can take that green visitor card to the Welcome Center on the other side of these walls. Join us for coffee and donuts and check out the Welcome Center. And we've got a gift for you just to say thank you for coming and being part of our worship service. Welcome also to those of you watching online. There is a QR code in the corner of your screen. If you would scan that with your phone, it'll take you to a connection card. Please fill that out so that we know who's worshiping with us on any given Sunday. We'll have more announcements later in the service. Invite you to stand as we continue with the confession of sin. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in our sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. May Almighty God strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Our opening hymn is in the bulletin, When Morning Gilds the Skies.
Thank you.
Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 16th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. From that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "God forbid it, Lord, this must never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are a stumbling block to me. You are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world, yet forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. So I'm going to have Eric play a little song for us on the radio. I don't know what you call that. On the computer to get started. When I was looking back at Moses' life, this song kept popping up in my mind. It's an old country song. It used to be sung at every wedding that I ever attended early in my career. It was, "God bless the broken road that led me straight to you." Does this sound familiar? Can you see the couple staring in each other's eyes? You know, as they dance their first dance, thinking about all the breakups that led to them coming together. It also tells me the story of Moses. Listen.
Many years ago, hoping I would find true love along the broken road. But I got lost a time or two, wiped my brow and kept pushing through. I couldn't see how every sign pointed straight.
Now you can sing along if you want.
That every long lost dream led me to where you are. Others who broke my heart, they were like northern stars, pointing me on my way into your loving arms. This much I know, that God bless the broken road that led me straight to you.
All right, that's probably enough. God bless the broken road that led me straight to you. It's a love song, but I think it also kind of shares the story of Moses' life, how it was a broken road. It wasn't a straight path to where he ended up. Moses' life did not go well. It did not go as planned. When he started out, he was under the order of Pharaoh. Every boy under 2 years old was to be killed, all the Hebrew boys. And so Moses' mother placed him in a basket and put it in the Nile River and hid him away to protect him from Pharaoh's army. And Pharaoh's daughter plucked him up out of the water. Moses, the name itself, means to be drawn from the water. That's what Moses means. And he was taken into the Egyptian palace and raised as an Egyptian. He had all the privileges of an Egyptian. He walked like an Egyptian. He talked like an Egyptian. I should have played that song. That would have been good. But his coloring and his features were still that of a Hebrew slave. And when he got older, he had affinity for the Hebrew people, and he saw one of them being mistreated by an Egyptian taskmaster, and Moses stood up for him and fought the Egyptian and ended up killing the Egyptian. And he knew at that moment that his life in the palace was over. He buried the body in the sand, and he fled for his life. Can you imagine being a fugitive like that, leaving everything you've known behind? Every dream he ever had for his life died with that Egyptian taskmaster. Moses flees to the wilderness. He helps out some women who are trying to water their sheep and are being harassed by some shepherds. and he chases the shepherds away, and he waters the women's sheep, and they take him home with them. And he meets their father, and he ends up marrying one of the girls, and he's adopted into their family, and he settles down as a shepherd. He wakes up in a tent instead of waking up in a palace. He spends his days walking the sheep through the wilderness to find places to graze. That's Moses' broken road. This is his life now, and he spends decades doing it. You know, many of us come to a settled place in our life where, whether we're happy or not with our professions, there comes a point in our lives where we just say, this is it. This is what I do now. This is my life. I might as well accept it. We come to a place where we no longer aspire to anything else, where we are content. We recognize that the time of choosing our path is over. All the moves to advance and to grow have been made, and we come to terms with where we've landed. Moses landed as a shepherd, and he became an old man doing that job, tending sheep that were not his own. They were owned by his wife's father. Now, this is a story for all of you who are over 60 years old. Of course, it is a story for everyone, but especially for those of you who are near the end of your working years or have landed into retirement. This is the life stage Moses was in when God changed his life forever. Moses had no idea that the most challenging, most significant days of his life were in front of him, not behind him. Moses had no idea that rather than fading into oblivion as an anonymous shepherd, he would become the most important leader in history. He's minding his own business, watching the sheep. He sees this bright flame within a bush, so bright it looks like the bush is on fire, but it's not burning. God gets Moses' attention through a burning bush. And Moses has a decision to make, a decision we all have to make when God tries to get our attention. Does he turn aside and investigate, or does he keep his head down and keep walking? Is he open to having his life changed through a conversation with a holy God, or is he too afraid of what that might mean? Is he too content with his life as it is? What do you do when God comes calling? You know, most of our life is ordinary. Most of our life is going through the routine habits of life. You get up, you get ready, you eat, you work, you play, you tend to your relationships, and then you go to bed. But occasionally, our life is interrupted by an invitation from God, an invitation to step out of those routines and find out what God is up to in this world. In this story, what God is up to is a plan to rescue the Hebrew slaves in Egypt. God has heard their prayer. He has remembered the covenant he made with Abraham that they would be a holy people in a land of their own, and he has decided to embark on a rescue mission to break them free from bondage and take them back to the promised land. His plan includes Moses, the old shepherd, who doesn't know it yet. Moses is the perfect candidate for this rescue mission. He knows the palace. He knows the Egyptian system. He grew up in it. He can navigate it. It's a huge advantage. And one of the things you can volunteer for around here is to be a cultural mentor for refugees coming to the United States who don't know our system, don't know how to set up a bank account or get a loan or any of that. And so Lutheran Family Services provides mentors to help people new to our society just find their way around. Moses didn't need a mentor. Moses didn't need a guide. He knew how Egyptian society worked. He could get an audience with Pharaoh. He could have his case heard. But besides being an Egyptian, Moses knew the wilderness. If he was able to get the people out of Egypt, they would need a guide to learn how to survive in the wild. Moses had spent decades living outside. He knew how to protect sheep. He knew how to find water. He knew how to find food. He knew how to survive in the wild. And God knew Moses would need those skills to help the newly freed slaves. And finally, Moses had a heart for the Hebrew people. The whole reason he's a fugitive is because he stood up in defense of the defenseless, in defense of a slave. Moses had God's heart for this people, a desire to protect them and keep them safe. This is the broken road of Moses' life, all adding up to exactly what God needs to launch this rescue mission. When I look at some of the staff at First Lutheran Church, I can't help but see how God has used their past, their life experience, to propel his mission forward in this place. Did you know that Pastor Carrie was an event planner for a helicopter company before she became a pastor? And we've seen those skills on display, that wonderful party that was thrown for us at the Peel House last week. And God uses those skills every week to create incredible celebrations and events that draw people closer to God and to one another. Michaela, our minister of faith formation, was working on her dissertation to be an art history professor when God called her to work at First Lutheran. Now she uses her amazing teaching abilities to lead the adult seminar, to teach the confirmation students, to preach on Wednesdays. Cheryl Mann, our coordinator of lay ministries, has had about 100 jobs. Read her resume someday. But they have equipped her perfectly for the crazy job that she has here. Did you know she was a software developer, a math teacher, a thriving financial rep, and a whole lot of other things, all of which has prepared her to manage our church database, to launch and shepherd new small groups, to recruit and retain new members, and lead us all in service to God. At First Lutheran, God's burning bush often looks like a phone call or an email from Cheryl. So if she comes calling, turn aside, investigate, pay attention. God calls out to Moses, inviting him to use all the pieces of his life in service to a mission from God, a mission to rescue people from bondage. When God calls us, it is always in service to others, in service to those in need. So Moses pays attention to the call. He picks up. He answers the call, shows up at the burning bush, and he begins a lengthy negotiation with God. Moses doesn't just say, yes, of course, I'll go. He pushes back. He argues. He gives excuses. He wants details. But God is patient with him and eventually convinces him to say yes and begin the journey that will radically change his life. But it starts with getting Moses' attention and Moses coming closer to investigate. I often wonder how often God is trying to get our attention and we're oblivious to it. How often is God trying to flag us down, get us to turn aside, and we just have our blinders on, going about our daily life? What if instead we started scanning the horizon, looking for burning bushes? What if we lived our lives with a kind of holy curiosity, wondering, I wonder what God's going to ask of me next? I wonder what God's going to invite me to do next? Mike and Yoshiko Ansbach, members of First Lutheran Church, recently felt this call to become foster parents. I asked Yoshiko how she knew, and she shared with me the many burning bushes that led them to make the decision. She said she was thinking about fostering, and then this movie, Instant Family, comes out. And then they go to a craft show, and there is a booth that Lutheran Family Services is running, inviting people to become foster parents. And then they're watching TV, and a commercial about fostering comes up. God was flagging them down. And then God gave them an experience. A friend of their daughter's was kicked out of her house for being gay. The Ansbachs took her in for 2 months until she graduated from high school. A final sign was a sermon they heard from First Lutheran about following God's call. She came to worship. God spoke to her in this room. And the next day, she handed in her resignation at her job to become a foster parent. And just like Moses, saying yes to the call has not been easy. They've had kids do major damage to their house. They've even gotten hurt by some of those kids. But they've also seen the fruit of their work, where kids find a safe home and feel empowered to succeed in life. Maybe their story will serve as a burning bush for someone else today. What do you do when God calls you? As Moses approached the bush, God told him to take off his shoes, for he was standing on holy ground. Taking off your shoes is a sign of worship. For us, it might be taking off our hat when we come into a sanctuary, or simply giving an hour of your life to worship God on a Sunday morning, especially a Sunday morning during a long holiday weekend. We come to worship in part because we are a people who recognize that God is present and active in this world. We aren't just going through the motions or checking some religious box. We come to pay attention to the God who is paying attention to us. We come to open our eyes to the God who sees this world, who sees us, and commissions us to serve and be part of what he is doing. When we worship, we hear the stories of how God has worked through others in the world, the way God chooses people and sends them out on a mission, so that we can better hear God when God calls us, so that we're ready to say yes when the invitation to us is issued. God might use any of us at any time. You might be 70 years old and see a burning bush, just like Moses did, and discover the most significant part of your life is ahead of you and not behind. You may be 30 years old and think you've got it all planned out, and then a broken road appears. Trust that God can take the disruption and the hardship and turn it into something that blesses people in need. We are a people who are on the lookout for God, ready to serve because we believe what God is up to in this world. That God is about saving people from sin, death, and the devil. That God is about rescuing people who are enslaved, who are oppressed, who are trapped. And we want to be part of the work to rescue them. That's why we're here. We have been rescued by Jesus. And now we're part of the rescue party. And we're ready when God flags us down to turn aside and pay attention, to hear the mission, and to accept. We're ready, right? Amen.
We do pray that God spoke to you today through the message. If you want to take next steps, we've created an online course called Basic Training that goes through the basics of the Christian faith, step by step. So I encourage you to take that. That's also on this YouTube channel. I encourage you to support this ministry online through your tithes and offerings. You can do that by going to our website, www.flccs.net. And then also in the description of this video, you'll see a link to a connection card. That's a great way to contact us. Let us know if you were moved to come to faith during this time, if you're ready to talk to a pastor about next steps. We'd love to talk to you there. Just let us know that you were here, and any comments, we appreciate that. May God bless you as you continue to walk with the Lord. Yeah.